Om Namah Shivaya, I'm Sanjita Roy. Welcome to class 12's biology class. Today I'm going to pick in chapter number 12, that is biotechnology and its application. In the previous chapter, we have already read about biotechnology, its principles and processes. We have seen that how the biotechnology functions. What was it? We are taking the desired gene from an organism. We isolate the DNA, we cut down the DNA with the help of the restriction endonuclease enzyme, and then we incorporate into a vector. A vector can be a plasmid, or it can be a bacteriophage or a cosmid. Anything can be utilized as a vector. So over here we can see the plasmid is isolated from the bacteria, and in that plasmid the desired gene is incorporated. And this gene is passed into this recombinant gene is passed into another bacteria. This bacteria will multiply, and then from here it will be passed on to the desired organisms, maybe it into the plants or to the other animals for their as per their necessity. So in this chapter we are going to see how the process of biotechnology is applied in the different fields and how it is important to us. Over here, what is there? Where do we see the application of biotechnology? If we see, the biotechnology is having a diversified application. Nowadays, it is a very promising field, and people and students especially, as because you are going to pass out from class 12, so those who are interested in bio-related, they can pursue biotechnology also, because there is a lot of scope in this field. Lot of research work is going in this field, and new more inventions are waiting in this field. So what are the different areas of field that biotechnology is working for? Medical diagnosis. In the human health care, it plays a very important and vital role. In the diagnosis of different types of diseases, to know about the different diseases, we massively take the help of the biotechnology. By the PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction, we come to know about the different diseases. At the same time, ELISA, they are all dependent upon the process of biotechnology. In the fermentation technology, we take the help of the biotechnology. Improvement of in the food technology, we are seeing day by day the food production has to be increased to support the growing population. But we also know that there is a constraint of land availability. So in the minimum land availabilities, how can we increase the process of cultivation? How can we develop a better crop? For that, the biotechnology plays a very important and vital role. Environmental and energy management. As we know, the basic source, the fossil fuels are used as an energy for us. But now we have to start thinking of an alternative way, because we know that the fossil fuels are depleting very rapidly. So we have to think of alternate means by which, like, biofuel has been come into the market. So we have to develop, we have to work, and biotechnology helps us to develop those type of energy management programs. Animal breeding agriculture. Animal breeding is an important factor. We need the cows to yield more milk for us. We need the poultry to produce more number of eggs. For that, we take the help of the biotechnology. Bioinformatics, it is a very important field in this now. Bioinformatics is about studying the genomes of the different organisms, of how we can utilize the genes of the different organisms to know about them and to pass on to the different fields of science. Proteomics and the genomics, it is another important place of the biotechnology. Plant agriculture, crop improvement. We have read from class 9 that how the crop improvement is important. We have to have a better quality of seeds. And for developing better quality of seeds, which will be higher yield, which can be more resistant to biotic and abiotic factors. So all those things, when we want to develop, we take the help of the biotechnology. Recombinant DNA technology is dependent upon the biotechnology and the healthcare pharmaceuticals on an everyday basis. Almost each and every person are dependent upon medicines, and the medicines are obtained by the help of the biotechnology. So these are the major applications of the biotechnology for which we need to study biotechnology. So biotechnology essentially deals with the industrial scale production of biopharmaceuticals and biologicals. So our main objective is to produce in large scale, and for the large scale production we need to know lot many things, how we can increase the production level. For that we need to study about the biotechnology. The applications of biotechnology include therapeutics, diagnostics, genetically modified crops for agriculture, processed food, bioremediation, waste treatment, and energy production. So these are the main areas where the biotechnology plays an important major role. Biotechnology have the following three critical research areas. In which areas the research work is massively going on in the field of biotechnology? To provide the best catalyst in the form of improved organisms using a microbe or pure enzyme. What is there? We have seen when we were discussing about the principles of biotechnology, we have seen there are several steps undergoing to develop a recombinant DNA. To form two mixed two DNAs, we need a number of organisms, we need the help of many things. For that, we need to know about them. So, to know about them, it is an important field where the research work is going on. That which type of bacteria has to be taken, that bacteria contains which type of plasmids, in which host can we transfer them. So these are one of the area of research work in the field of biotechnology. To create optimal conditions through engineering for a catalyst to act, you can see different types of machineries are utilized in this field. To know about them, for that is another area where the engineering part is also important in the field of biotechnology. Biotechnology, as we know at the beginning only said, we are talking about the living things as well as we are talking about the technology. We need different types of devices. Just we have seen that we need electrophoresis device, we need the centrifugation devices. So there are number of devices utilized for performing the experiments. For that, this is a micropipette is being utilized. These are a type of technologies. So these are the things developed by the help of engineering. So what type of devices will be helpful for performing the experiments or to increase the production is also very important field in the biotechnology, where lot amount of research work is going on. The third field where the research work is going on is the downstream processing technologies to purify the protein or the organic compound. We have developed the recombinant DNA, we have transferred it, and we are working with a good quality of engineering. We are producing large scale products of our desire. Finally, the thing is that downstream processing is what, how are we going to conserve, preserve, and market it into the, so sell them in the market. That is the area where the third field of biotechnology where the research is going on. Because when we are producing a medicine, if the longevity, if the expiry date of the medicine is a longer time period, it will be beneficial for us. We have seen that whenever we consume any medicine, whether it is antibiotic or a non-antibiotic, we will see that every medicine, every food items is having an expiry date. That beyond that date, if we consume it, it will be harmful. So if we can increase the longevity of the substances produced, then it will be of great help for us. So the downstream processing is improved, then we can preserve the things for a longer time period. Now, biotechnological applications in the field of agriculture. At the beginning only I said that it plays an important role in the field of agriculture. So biotechnology application in agriculture involve following three options: agrochemical based agriculture, where we are utilizing different chemicals for increasing our yield, organic agriculture, it is a very hot thing in the market. Everywhere we go, we will see that this is an organic fruit, organic vegetables. What is organic? Where there is a minimum or no application of harmful chemicals in the form of fertilizers or pesticides are used. So they are referred as organic agriculture because at the initial time we have utilized huge amount of fertilizers, pesticides to protect our crops. But as the time passed, we came to know that they are entering into the food chain of the different groups level of organisms, and it is causing a massive problem. In the human beings, different types of diseases, different types of new types of diseases are coming up because of the continuous consumption of the high amount of fertilizers and chemicals in our diet. So people are now moving into the organic agriculture process. Number C is genetically engineered crop-based agriculture. We can increase the agricultural yield by involving genetically engineered crop based when we are manipulating and we are developing some disease resistant, pest resistant plants, then it will be of great help and we can increase our yield. Green revolution increased fruit production due to the use of improved crop varieties. We improved the crop varieties that we have read that higher yield, biotic, abiotic resistance, desirable trait, change in durations. So these are the few areas where we have tried to improve the crop varieties. Next is the agrochemicals. We have started using different types of chemical fertilizers, pesticides, which help us to increase the food grain production. That is the green revolution. And the last is a better management practice. We have adopted different types of management practice. Different types of machineries are utilized over here. We can see that how the watering is being done, the irrigation is done to the crops. Over here, drones are being taken to apply the fertilizers or pesticides. Instead of the farmer going into and damaging the crops, we are taking the help. So the technology is playing a very important role in the field of agriculture also. Genetically modified organisms are what? They are the plants, animals, bacteria and fungi whose genes has been altered by manipulation. For example, the genes are extracted from a desired plant and then it is incorporated into another plant. So this plant which we have developed, the new plant which we have developed by the taking the new genes from another organism, we call it as genetically modified organisms. So in this way, we are developing different types of plants, animals, bacteria and fungi. You will see that in case of the bacteria, like in E. coli, in the later part of the chapter, we will see that in the E. coli, we are growing a part of the insulin. So that E. coli is becoming a genetically modified organism. So whenever a foreign gene is incorporated into the host plant, the plant is now referred as a genetically modified organism. Genetic information modification in plants have led to the following. When we have done the genetic engineering, when we have changed the genome of the plants, what are the things we have seen? Crops became more tolerant to abiotic stress such as cold, drought, salt, heat, etc. So the plants can be grown in an area where it is too cold or there is a drought condition or in the salt or the heat condition, the plants are able to grow. Now we have seen that the weather in different parts of the country, rather in the different parts of the world, changes drastically. There are certain extreme climatic conditions are developing in the areas. For that, we have to develop the plants which can tolerate the different type of abiotic stress factors. Dependence on chemical pesticides reduced. We have developed plants where we will making the plant pest resistant. We are incorporating the genes of an organism into the plant and making the plant pest resistant so that the insects does not come and eat or damage the plant. So the dependence on the chemical, earlier times we used to apply pesticides randomly. But by now we have understood that the pesticides are highly dangerous for not only for the insects but also for human beings and the other group of animals which are dependent upon them, like the birds. They are also getting affected because of the excessive use of pesticides. Post-harvest losses reduced. By the massive use of these genetic engineering, what we have done, we can reduce the post-harvest loss. When the harvest is done and the grains are not, or the vegetables are not consumed immediately. So by the help of the genetic engineering, we can increase the longevity of the fruits or vegetables we are producing. For example, the tomatoes, now we see that mostly they are genetically engineered, they are developed by certain means so that they can stay fresh for a longer time period. Efficiency of the mineral usage increased in the plants. We are developing plants which will efficiently utilize the minerals from the soil. That means they will not dependent upon different types of fertilizers, so that the use of fertilizers can be reduced to a lot of extent. The next is the nutritional value of the food is enhanced. We are developing plants where the nutritional value of the food plant increases. For example, the rice. We know that rice, why do we consume rice? We consume rice to obtain carbohydrates. Now we are doing another addition into it, that biofortification, that is called biofortification, when we are adding vitamin A into the rice and we are growing it. So this type of development is helping in improving the quality of the food. Tailor-made plants are created by using genetic modified plants to supply alternative resources to industries in the form of starch, fuel, and the pharmaceuticals. So these are the different fields where the genetic modification in plants have been led to. Some of the applications of biotechnology in the agriculture are the production of pest-resistant plants. Just now I said that to reduce the usage of pesticide, we have developed plants which are pest-resistant. How we have developed it over here? It is said that the beet toxin is produced by a bacterium and expressed in the plants to provide resistance to insects. There is a bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis. From there it comes the BT. Bacillus B and thuringiensis T comes from there. This beet toxin is produced by the bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis. This Bacillus thuringiensis, as it produces the protein that is called beet toxin crystal, that is very harmful for certain types of insects. Like there are certain beetles, there are certain dipterans which can be killed by the help of this type of crystals. So by the help of biotechnology, what we have done, we have extracted the gene from the bacteria and of the beet which is responsible for producing the beet toxin, and we have incorporated, we have passed on to the plants, like the corn plant and the cotton plant. And these modified plants are called beet corn and beet cotton. That is, beet T is for Bacillus thuringiensis and BT corn and beet cotton plants. Okay, now how does it work over here? So what are the plants where we have done this? We have done it in beet cotton, beet corn, golden rice, tomato, potato and soybean. Now let us understand, beet cotton is created by using some strains of a bacteria, Bacillus thuringiensis. This bacteria produces proteins that kill certain insects such as lepidopterans, coleopterans and dipterans. These are the main insects which the main groups of insects which have been killed by the help of the Bacillus thuringiensis beet toxin protein. Bacillus thuringiensis forms a protein crystals during a particular phase of their growth. This crystal contains a toxic insecticidal protein. That protein which is produced by Bacillus thuringiensis, it is toxic, it is harmful for the insecticidal plant, but it is not harmful for the plant. It is harmful for the insects. insects of which group? Lepidopterans, coleopterans and dipterans. These are important for the exam. Okay, now big toxin per protein exists as an inactive protoxin. Normally when the bacteria produces this toxin, it is in a proactive form, in the inactive form, that is called the protoxins. But when this toxin is consumed by the caterpillar, we know that the insects are feeding in the caterpillar phase. So when the toxin is consumed by the caterpillar, when it enters into the digestive tract of the caterpillar, in the tract it gets the alkaline medium. Over there, when it gets the alkaline medium, the big toxin crystal dissolves. Okay, it gets disintegrated, and these particles, these toxins, binds to the epithelial lining of the digestive tract of the caterpillar. Because of this toxins getting released or dissolved in the alkaline medium, it causes swelling and it develops pores in the digestive tract. As the pores develop in the digestive tract, the food particles passes out, and due to which the caterpillar dies. So this is the basic principle how we are trying to develop a crop which is pest resistant. We will not use any harmful chemicals, only we are taking the gene from the Bacillus thuringiensis and passing it into the corn plant or the cotton plant. Big toxin protein exists in an inactive protoxins, but once an insect injects the inactive toxin, it is converted to an active form of the toxin due to the alkaline pH of the gut, which solubilizes the crystals. The activated toxin binds to the surface of the midgut epithelial cells and create pores that cause cell swelling and lysis, leading to death of an insect. Specific big toxin in genes were isolated from Bacillus thuringiensis and incorporated into several crop plants as cotton. Most big toxins are the insect group specific. The toxin is coded by a gene called CRI. We know that DNA contains large number of genes. So the gene which is responsible for the production of the big toxin, that gene is referred as CRI. The proteins encoded by the gene CRI, IAC and CRI2AB control the cotton bollworms, and CRI1AB controls the corn borer. So these are the different types of genes which are present in the bacteria, which are taken out, extracted from the bacteria, and then they are passed into the corn plant or the cotton plant. Now we develop the pest resistant plants by using the biotechnological processes. A Nematoda melanogen incognita infects the root of the tobacco plants, which reduces the production of the tobacco. If this bacteria is in, this nematoda is infecting the roots of the plant, it decreases the plant production. Because if the root is damaged, then automatically the plant production will get decreased. So we take the help of RNA interference process is used for cellular defense. It involves silencing of a specific mRNA due to a complementary double-stranded RNA. It occurs in all eukaryotic organisms as a method of cellular defense. What is there? We know that from the DNA, RNA is formed, and from the RNA, the protein formation takes place, that is translation. And we know that RNA is a single-stranded structure. But over here, what we are doing, we are taking a double-stranded, we are passing a gene which will produce a complementary RNA structure, and this will develop into a double-stranded structure. So the complementary RNA structure, that is a double-stranded RNA, will form. When two RNAs are complementary to each another, they will bind together. Like the DNA is a double helical structure, similarly RNAs, when they get the two complementary strands, then they will bind together and they will form a double helical structure. If the two strands are bound together, then the RNA cannot undergo the process of translation. So no protein synthesis will take place. So we take the help of the RNA interference, which will produce a double-stranded RNA, and it will help in the forming a complementary RNA strand, which will bind to the mRNA and prevent the mRNA from synthesizing the necessary proteins for the nematoda. So double-stranded RNA binds and prevents translation of the mRNA, that is called silencing, because the RNA cannot get itself expressed. When it cannot express itself, we call it a silencing. The source of this complementary RNA could be from an infection by viruses having RNA genomes or mobile genetic elements that replicate via an RNA intermediate. Agarobacterium vectors are used. Which type of vectors we are taking? Agarobacterium vectors are used to introduce nematode-specific genes into the host plant. The host plant is which plant? Tobacco plant. The vector is Agarobacterium. And we are taking the gene and we are passing it to the host plant. It produces both sense and antisense RNA in the host plants, which will help in the silencing of the RNA produced by the nematoda. These two RNAs are complementary to each other and forms a double-stranded RNA. This initiate RNA interference and hence silence the specific mRNA of the nematoda. When the nematoda now infects in the plant of the tobacco plant cells will produce the complementary RNA and it will form the double-stranded RNA and which will prevent the process of protein synthesis in case of the nematoda. And when the nematoda is unable to produce its protein, it will die. The parasite cannot survive in the transgenic host expressing specific interfering RNA. The transgenic plant thus gets into protected from the parasite. So ultimately, the plant gets protected from the pathogen. So over here, you can see how the thing double-stranded RNA is forming. If the double-stranded RNA, withdrawal of the double-stranded with smaller fragments, then one of the RNA strands is loaded with another protein complex. So they are binding together and it is preventing the RNA for producing protein by the nematoda, and gradually the nematoda, without the production of its protein necessary for its survival, it will die. So in the next video we will see that how the biotechnology is used in the field of diagnosis and in the therapeutic use of the biotechnology. Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.